Folks, welcome inside the Parisi Palace, high above 3733's Broadway. This is a live edition of the Jake Feinberg Show, coming to you live on Power Talk. Please go to our website, powertalk.live. Download our free app and stream all of our live local programming, including Solomon on Blast, the Jim Parisi Show, and yours truly, the Jake Feinberg Show. And we can't thank you enough for making us part of your day today, and it's an honor to bring back a friend of the program, the guy whose family has been stretching the vocabulary of music for the last several decades, many decades, and drummer Albert Tootie Heath, welcome back to the Jake Feinberg Show.
Thank you, Jake. It's good to be back. Hello, everybody.
Yes, it's an honor to talk to you. I wanted to read this quote from Donald Duck Bailey. Rest in peace. He said,
Oh, yeah, man. That was my man, Philadelphia's own.
Yeah, so let me read you this, and then you can riff on it. He said, this is from my interview with him back in January of 2012. I said, he said, my main mentor was a drummer named Earl Curry, who was the house
drummer. Mine, too. Yeah, mine, too.
All right, so he goes on to say he's a house drummer at an after-hours club in Philly. We would, when all the musicians came into town, they would all go to this after-hours club. You'd have all the great players, Benny Golson, Eddie Lockjaw Davis, Jimmy Heath, John Coltrane, all lined up waiting to play with this house band. I just wanted you to talk about what made this cat a mentor. Did he teach you how to play the shuffle rhythm?
No, it was a drummer named Specs Charles Wright that taught me. Because Earl Curry lived in a different part of the city from me and Donald. Donald lived in North Philly. I lived in South Philly. But the After Hours place, I'm trying to think of where it was. I can't remember where it was.
Yeah.
Or the name of it.
I mean, he said, you know, he goes on to say, that, I mean, I guess what I'm trying to say is, like, your brother was there, but you were lined up as well. I'm trying to get the idea of when Tootie Heath first went. I mean, a lot of cats went to Bop City, you know, and it's
but Bop City was in San Francisco,
right? So what I'm saying is, when they were younger, they were going to Bop City, and they'd get up on the bandstand, and someone like Tommy Flanagan or someone like that would say, "All right, man, thanks a lot." Like, either they'd stay on the stand if you could do it, or if not, they couldn't. I was just wanted to know about when you first got up on the bandstand with guys that were older than you, and they didn't leave the bandstand.
You know what? I don't remember the place or an after-hours place in Philadelphia. I really don't. I'm trying to, recall where we played after hours. There were several places where we would play, and it wasn't like sitting in. It was professional clubs. You know, one was called Spider Kelly's. I remember that.
Sure.
But, I mean, that was not a jam session. You know, that was professional people playing. And I played in there with a guy named Jimmy Oliver. And Donald Duck Bailey, the first time I saw this guy, he was in his mother's home, him and his brother, Morris, who's a bass player. I don't know if Morris is still with us or not, but his brother played bass, and Donald played drums. And he had, from high school, Donald had become very good in machine shop. So he made all of the hardware for a drum kit. It was like coat hangers and stuff like that. Man, it was an unusual drum kit, you know? And this guy was down in the basement, and we used to go and peep down there. I'd go up, you know, we'd get on the trolley car and go uptown and peep in the basement. He would be practicing, man, and he had cymbals with rivets in them like the companies do it now, but he had rivets all the way around the cymbal, which was a unique sound and very different from anybody else's. And then he made his own hi-hats out of ashtrays. There used to be metal ashtrays in the nightclub, in the bars, because when people would start fighting, you know, they would break, the ashtrays would be on the table, and that's the first thing they would break is the ashtrays. So they started putting metal ashtrays on the tables. And Donald Bailey put two metal ashtrays together, and it made hi-hats, you know. So his drum set had a sound like a junk track, junk wagon coming down the street. but this guy would be practicing and playing some of the most ridiculous stuff I had ever heard, and maintaining the swing rhythm and independently doing all this other stuff. But the sounds were so different because he had ashtrays banging, and, you know, all his stuff was homemade. But we used to go and look at this guy, and we said, oh, man. So Art Blakey found out about him. I forgot how. But Art Blakey gave him a drum set, and that was it.
He gave him a traditional trap set.
Yeah, he gave him a real drum set, and this guy got on those, and that's the history of Donald Bailey. Then he joined Jimmy Smith with the organ trio, and that was one of the swingingest groups you ever wanted to hear.
It was a Thornell
with Donald Bailey.
And Quentin Bailey?
Thornell Swartz.
I was
guitar.
Dejanette said that.
And
Dejanette said that, that Bailey was had one of the most unique sounds on the track.
He did.
When Blakey gave him more traditional trap set, he still had the same kind of junk sound, or it was different?
No, he had, it sounded like a real drum set, but he had his drum set up very different. Like, you wouldn't want to go sit in nowhere after Donald Bailey, because he'd have the snare drum would be cocked to the side real strange, like a marching drummer, and he would play with one big stick and one small stick. He was unusual, man, and he was unique, and he had his own style early in the game. Although, you know, with all the influences, Philly Joe and Elvin and all those people, Art Blakey, who gave him the drums, he still had his own stuff, but it was basically accompanying style of playing, not all over the place with dropping bombs and stuff. He was really a swing drummer, man, and he was a master at.
Right. No, I mean,
but I still don't know, Jake. I still can't remember where we would play the after hours. I'm still trying to remember in Philadelphia. He didn't name it, did he?
Well, he actually was unable to remember it as well. He said,
yeah.
He said this. He said, if you want peace, then put jazz up there. You'll have a peaceful world. Look how the world is acting all crazy because they don't have jazz like it used to be. People go crazy without jazz. Look at Dizzy Gillespie. He was a good example. When he went on the bandstand, he went up a great musician. He also went up to have fun. He'd go up there with Ella Fitzgerald and maybe kiss her. Then he'd go in to start improvising, which is what music is all about. There's some orchestration, but basically the music is well done. If the music are able to improve their improvisation and the association of others, we need an audience because the musicians feed off their energy. And he's talking about jazz the way it used to be, and that creates a peaceful world. I mean, I also wanted to ask you, it's a twofold question. Do you agree that if we had a legitimate touring circuit for improvisatory music, that it would be a more peaceful world? And number two, I would like you to talk about your concept of the word jazz and if you think it's a useful term.
Well, number one, to answer that question about jazz making it a peaceful world, I think we need a little more than that to make this world peaceful. It's kind of messed up, and we like war more than anything else. And our country is definitely a war country, and now we are ignoring veterans and people on the street and people who need help. We ignore all of that, and we got all of these people in Congress and government that are zillionaires, and their families are all secure in life and go to the best schools and the best hospitals and the best doctors, and here we are, people just suffering. I don't think jazz can do anything about that. I think it takes a little more than jazz. Jazz is music, and people enjoy it, but I mean, some people enjoy it. Everybody doesn't like it. It's not wonderful, especially improvising. People don't know what the hell is going on in that improvisation. It gets too long and too many notes. And nowadays, to answer the second question, nowadays, the music is coming from the head and not from the heart. It's learned in colleges and schools. Lester Young said once, they quoted him, they asked Lester, well, how do you like all the new saxophone players? And he said, well, they all have the same teachers, which meant that the teachers who taught in the colleges are all teaching the same concept, which is sequences and notes, and how many notes can you play. So, I mean, we got away from the heart stuff where we played from what we learned from our neighborhoods and growing up. We don't do that anymore. We play from the head now. It's intellectual. So that answers question number two. Music has become, jazz especially, has become very intellectual. And I think if it wasn't for hip-hop, we wouldn't have any kind of music that relates to people.
I'm curious about if you could share a story about Percy and Jimmy and yourself in the neighborhood playing from the heart. I mean, I don't know if people are really going to. I've done 1,000 interviews with you cats, so I get it. But what can you give an example of neighborhood rhythm, neighborhood melody that came from the heart and not the head?
Well, yeah. For instance, if you take Count Basie and listen to his orchestra, and you listen to, say, like Woody Herman and his orchestra, and you will hear the difference. One music is esoteric and one is not. You know, it came from, our music came from bars and churches and neighborhood music. People listened to each other and played what each other played. We imitated whoever was the current person at the time, which was not an academic person. It was, you know, actually college and school was not an option when I came along. That was an exception. So people who went to and learned how to play music through college was unusual because they learned academically. So now that's where music is, especially improvising. I believe that the improvising has left the heart and the soul of people, and you playing what you experience in the neighborhood, like, for instance, a crap game on the corner. I mean, where would you see that nowadays? Nowhere. Guys shooting dice on the street corner and giving the kids $1 to tell them when the police is coming, because they weren't allowed to do that. They would be arrested if they got caught. Hmm. So, I mean, all of that kind of stuff is in the music. And people in neighborhoods were, you know, where everything was like, you know, the funeral parlor, the grocery store, the church, it was all right in the neighborhood. You could walk to all of that. The bakery shop, everything was right there where you could, you know, walk to it and use whatever you needed. And all of that was, and then we had hucksters that used to come through the block with horse and wagons and selling fruit, and they had special songs or a way of announcing them coming through the neighborhood. So all of that was in the music. And, you know, the blues, of course, came from our suffering and how horrible it was to grow up in these neighborhoods. You know, how bad it was. It wasn't horrible. It was bad, but we survived. You know, we're still here. And some people, a few guys still around, they play that kind of music. And some of us have adopted, you know, that kind of music. And some of us have gone on to universities and become doctors and professors, musicologists, they call them. Well, we were all musicologists because we studied from each other, and that's how we learn. Nowadays, it's quite different. It's intellectual, which, you know, some of it I don't mind, but most of it I'd rather not hear it.
Do you feel like, I mean, so many of the cats that you played with at that time, Clifford Jordan, Johnny Griffin, Dexter, so many of these guys who played from the heart, who played from real life experience, came from the blues, they left this country because of the color bar. And I just recently interviewed David Clayton Thomas from Blood, Sweat, and Tears, and there was no color bar in Canada. I interviewed John Mayall last year, and he said there's no color bar in England. I mean, how much of it is, do you feel like this is a natural evolution away from?
Well, let me tell you this. You have to have a color in order to say that there's no color bar. If you have one, then you know that there is. But guys that don't have it, like John Mayer and all those people you name live in Canada and whatever, they don't have color bar because they're not color. They don't have a color skin. If you have this skin, then you understand what color bar is, and you understand the racism and how you're not chosen because of your color. And so guys left for other reasons this country, not because it was any better overseas, because it was the same thing, but with an accent. There were still the same racist people that came to this country that lived over there, and they're still there. Now you got all these immigrants that want to come into this country, and people don't want to let them in because of them being immigrants. But we're all immigrants except for the slaves that came in this country. Slaves weren't invited here, and they didn't come here for a better life. They were brought here. So that's a difference in the color thing. You can't talk about it's no color bar if you don't have a color, you know, if you're not subject to that experience. And the only way to be subject to that experience is you look around in the world and you see how people that have a particular color or of a particular culture are kind of ignored or pushed under the rug because of this thing that happens to us of our skin color, which is kind of ridiculous. It's like saying people with blue eyes are, you know, devils or something, whatever, you know, we've named each other. Because we live in this society where you have to call something a name in order to destroy it. And the word jazz, I come from the area or the era where, like, some of my colleagues didn't like the term because where it was presented in bars and prostitution houses, and jazz was not a music that was considered sophisticated. It was always in some place where everybody was drunk and full of smoke. The room was full of smoke, and, you know, it wasn't on the concert stage. So once jazz had presented itself now to the concert stage, or is introduced to festivals all over the world, and the people that play it don't necessarily represent the people from my era anymore, because we've died out. But we the last of the... I consider myself one of those people who came from, like, the area where the blues was important and the R&B was important and church gospel music was important. It's not a part of what they call jazz anymore. People ignore that. That is not intellectual. That is not taught at the university. They don't teach you nothing about no blues, how to play a 12-bar, 8-bar blues. They don't teach you that at the universities. They teach you about sequences and how to go from this kind of change to that kind of change, where we didn't even know what that was, you know, most of us.
Well, no, I want to ask you if you feel like the pentatonic scale is purposely ignored because the systems are inherently white.
Yeah, that's true. It's not that it's white. It's that it's intellectual. They've gone beyond the pentatonic scale. They've added to it. But the pentatonic scale was the basis of most of our music. Like Duke Ellington said, 1 foot in the future and 1 foot in blues, you know, would make the music unique.
Well, I got a piece of music here for you, Tootie. I want you to listen to it, see if you can figure it out, and then we'll come back and break it down.
Okay. Down with this. God, I promise this guy I would do this today.
Mr. Heath, what do you got for us?
Yeah, Jake, that was Clifford Jordan.
Oh, you nailed it. Do you have any idea what tune that was?
No, I don't remember the name of the tune, but I remember him playing that.
Yeah, well, that's
and playing it with him.
Yeah, that was on Strata East, an album, In the World, 1969. It was Don Cherry on cornet, Julian Priester on trombone, Clifford Jordan, Wynton Kelly on piano, Wilbur Ware on bass, Richard Davis on bass and cello, Albert Heath on drums. I mean, to me.
Yeah, I don't remember that session, but I remember that piece, Clifford, we used to play that piece a lot. I don't know the name of it, though.
It was called Vienna.
Yeah, okay.
I mean.
Vienna?
Vienna, V-I-E.
Oh, Vienna, like Austria.
Exactly, exactly. And I just wanted you to talk about the intermeshing of all the different musics there. I mean, to me, there was the blues. There was a classical. Again, the banjo came from Africa. And I just wanted.
Yeah, I love a banjo. I love a banjo.
You love the banjo.
But we don't use a banjo in whatever music it is that we're playing nowadays, the improvisational thing called jazz. They don't use the banjo.
Yeah, and why do you think? Because it's not a brass instrument, or how it's not considered?
I don't know. I don't think the timbre of the banjo, people don't use it in what we call jazz, but it's in traditional music, like traditional jazz, New Orleans music. It'll be heard in that, but not in, the string instrument, number one, guitars, and banjo and all those string instruments like that were rhythm instruments. And the banjo was definitely a rhythm instrument. And it was not a solo instrument. So when the saxophone took over as a solo instrument, that knocked the rhythm instruments out of business. You know, like, no more guitar players want to play the guitar like Freddie Green did with Count Basie's band, where he just did the thing they call the strumming.
Right. No, you nailed it.
Went along with the bass and the drums, and it was supportive as opposed to a solo instrument. Now everybody wants to play 1,000 notes on the guitar, and it's amplified, and it's awful.
No, I was going to say, because you just nailed, going back to that analogy you made between Count Basie and Woody Herman, that was exactly.
Oh, yeah. I mean. Yeah, that was the difference. That was the color line right there.
So, I mean, Tootie, you still are playing quite a bit. I mean, how is it best? What is the best use of your time when you are not playing with your peers? How do you try to get this across to younger cats who, quite honestly, their ears might very well be locked? Because, like with Odine Pope used to play at Spider Kelly's with Coltrane. But before that, they would practice every tune. Every note, they'd be able to play the same tune in every key. And that doesn't happen anymore. So the kids' ears are locked. How do you try to unlock their ears?
Well, you know what Charlie Parker told me one time when I was, I'd asked him a question about what did he practice. He told me, you listen to the radio and everything that comes on there, you play with it and you figure out what key it's in and you play with it. And once you do that, that means you cross styles, you cross tonalities, you cross every element possible in music. And I think that's very true. And I don't tell kids to practice what they hear on the radio because they don't really listen to the radio now. It's all online. Everything is online now. And, you know, so they don't have the variety. Either you're listening to hip-hop or you're not. That's what it is today. And other than pop music, then popular music, what's his name? Justin Bieber and those kind of people present another kind of music that young people are interested in because it is attractive because of the money that they make doing that music. They don't make any money imitating Ornette Coleman or Coltrane. That's artistic. You know, they don't make money doing that.
I know, but there's also this authenticity gap because you have people that are propped up as superstars, but they're not even real musicians. I guess what I'm trying to say is what do you try to implore to younger peeps, especially on the bandstand? Like, you just went back to you go back to New York and play with younger cats. I mean, how do you?
I'm getting ready to go. I'm getting ready to leave Friday and play at Mesro with Ethan Iverson and David Williams, bassist, who used to play with Cedar a lot.
Absolutely.
And Ethan is kind of a piano player that's capable of whatever it is that you need to do to survive as a jazz musician. He knows how to do it all, and he's probably classically taught, so he didn't allow them to just teach him that, and but he went and learned other stuff, so he knows Duke Ellington pieces, he knows Monk pieces, he knows, you know, anything I call, he can come up with it.
You know, Kenny Burrell told me that growing up in Detroit was like going to a jazz university. He'd wind up, you know, buying music, exchanging music, transcribing stuff off of records. Can you go back and talk about a time when your brothers and you put together something that was completely your own by doing that outside of academia?
Well, the person who was the musical director of our group was Jimmy Heath, who had a unique ability for writing songs, and he still does jazz compositions, and he still does even today at the age of 90 years old. He's still performing, and I just talked to him the other day. We're going to play at the Vanguard in April, I think. July, I'm sorry. In July, we're going to play at the Vanguard in New York City. So it's still the Heath Brothers without Percy, but he uses a bassist named David Wong, who is quite a young bass player, and you know, but I miss Percy, and I always will, and I think that was one of the main points in my learning to play. It was to play with him, and Jimmy had his academic stuff that he got from his peers. He learned. Jimmy didn't go to school either, but he's one of the major jazz writers of today, but he learned from his peers. Like Dizzy used to come by the house and teach him harmony, and Miles Davis, and a lot of people used to come by my mother's house and teach Jimmy on the piano and show him some progressions and things like that. And he applied that to writing for big bands. He loves big bands. And he still writes right now today. He's still doing it at 90 years old. So, Percy and Jimmy, we got a unique thing together simply because we listen to each other. And because of our age differences, I was able to become a person that was, I was always a student with both of these guys because they had a little more experience than me. I hadn't learned to play with all of these people like Jimmy or Percy had been doing, you know, so it gave me a learning experience like it was unique, and that's how we came up with the Heath Brothers sound, if you want to call it that.
Percy was not academically trained, but he helped you. You guys learned. He taught you how to stay out of his way. Can you talk about how you?
Percy taught me how to play time, which was one of his specialties. Was not how many notes you play, but the clarity and the tonality and the tempo was important things for his bass playing. Why he was chosen. During the 50s, he was on more recordings than anybody in the 50s. So he taught me a lot about playing with a bass player, with the other musicians, with improvising. He taught me a lot of that. And with Jimmy, I learned a lot about composition. And I even tried to write a couple of songs because of his influence. But that's what I learned from both of those guys. I'm still learning from Jimmy right now, because Percy's gone, but I still learn from Jimmy, because he's still writing songs, even for a small group, he does too.
Do bass players, like you talked about this academic trend of teaching these different modalities or styles, and it's about technique and playing all these different notes. Are bass players also encountering the same kind of problem? They're playing too much as opposed to Percy?
Absolutely. Absolutely, bass players are now. Bass has become a solo instrument now, as opposed to an accompanying, as well as the drums. You know, Tony Williams and Elvin Jones have influenced the drumming to become more of improvisational, as opposed to supportive to the music that's going on. The drummer's place to be was accompanying, along with the piano and the bass. And the guitar was there. It was also considered a rhythm instrument, supportive. Now all of those are solo instruments. Drummers can play solos. Some people, thanks to Max Roach, drummers started to think about playing melodically, you know, which wasn't happening other than Max Roach. You know, Art Blakey was more into swings. Philly Joe was into swing as well. But, you know, the drums, all of the instruments have changed. This is a new time. This is 2017. This is a new date. And we're talking about how people played in the 30s and 40s. It's quite different. We don't even talk the same. We don't do nothing the same anymore.
We don't.
Our parents don't stay together like they used to stay together. My wife's mother and father stayed together until they were 90, both of them. My parents stayed together until they were way in their 70s, but their health wasn't good, so they didn't stay around that long. But people stayed together for a long time. And now, you know, you get a divorce, you know, you look at these people on TV, they get married, and then they get a divorce immediately. I mean, a few years. So this is a different time.
I was going to ask you, Reggie Workman told me that he could go see a 45-minute set of quote-unquote jazz, and it's really nice, and it's very tight. But he said there are drummers that won't touch the cymbals. Do you feel like the cymbals have become not used appropriately? I mean, I listen to your cymbal work, but the idea is that there were cats like Kenny Clark and yourself and, you know, it didn't matter who it was, Tiny Khan and Rashid Ali. These guys kept time on the cymbals. I mean, have people just, has it because we've had this drum machine crunched into our ears for so long that people no longer understand the value of the cymbals? Do you agree with Workman?
Well, I don't agree. No, I don't agree that they don't use, because all the drummers that I know do play time on their cymbals. They're not just made for crashing and banging, but they're punctuating, I should say. But they are drummers who had a unique sound on their cymbals. Connie Kay was one of them.
Right.
So was Kenny Clark, Art Blakey. They all had a unique sound. You could almost tell when you heard a recording, you knew who it was immediately, who playing the drums, if you were probably interested or sensitive around drummers, because of the cymbal sound. And the cymbal sound was the main beat to the music. it created the music. And the cymbal rhythm came from the tambourine rhythm that came from the church. That's where the cymbal beat came from. And then it was changed. Now it's more academic, and it's got 16th notes as opposed to a triplet sound. It's changed quite a bit. And Lou Hayes is one of the few guys around that, I'm sure there are more, but I'm not in New York, so I haven't heard all these young people. But Lou Hayes is one who is very concerned about the cymbal rhythm. That's why his beat is so special. And Jackie Williams, there are a few drummers, Leroy Williams, there are a few guys around. Ben Riley, there's some more guys. Jimmy Cobb, who I've been listening to with some of Miles' recordings.
Oh, yeah.
Jimmy Cobb laid it down, and he didn't mess around with a whole lot of bombs and things like that. When Tony Williams came around, it changed the whole drumming, the consciousness of playing the time, which he did that, but he did other things with it. And so did Elvin, had a unique sound, you know, with Coltrane. Those two, it was like a marriage, you know, and they influenced a lot of us drummers. Roy Haynes was another one.
I mean,
so I can name guys. Yeah, go ahead.
No, I was going to say that I transcribed from our first interview. You were talking about when rock and roll came in and it got all this media attention and it was white people's blues. That's what you always considered it. And then obviously became theatrical with people smashing guitars and all these histrionics. And going back to what Donald Bailey said, I mean, more jazz would not equal more peace. But the rock music became angrier, louder, more histrionics, and to the point now where I'm not even sure there's very little dynamics in pop and rock music today. And I just wonder if that has moved us towards an angrier, more hyperbolic. Not that there weren't major issues when you were coming up, but the volume of the music is so loud now that it's just you.
Yeah.
Either you are pacified, it's for pacification, or you just tune it out as elevator music, you know. And that.
Well, go ahead.
Well, that's what I was just getting back to, this Donald Bailey point, where you had these touring circuits, you'd have these residencies. I mean, I'm sorry, but the Jim Queskin Jug Band had a 3-week residency at the Troubadour, and Duke Ellington came in and was so infatuated by Bill Keith's pedal steel guitar that he came backstage. I mean, my point is that there were a lot of places to play, and there was a lot of melodic improvisation going on, and there was a lot of camaraderie going on. And it just sort of struck my attention when you said with rock, you know, when it got into this glam rock and Guitar Hero and people started smashing things, and all of a sudden it became about this sort of, I just sort of started to think to myself, man, you know, did white people just co-opt music and get off on rock because it was white and therefore they could drive that and make money off of it? I mean, I mean, just call me naive, but when I transcribed this quote from you the other day, it just kind of blew my mind a little bit.
Well, I think music and everything else is influenced by the media, our television and our recording industry, and it's all influenced by the media. So I think this is only my personal thought about rock music. I think it's, some of it is very good. Some of the songs are played are very good, and some of it is not. It's like anything else. Some jazz is good, and some jazz is not good. There's too many notes in some of it. But the rock music has become very visual. You know, guys slinging hair around and, like you say, breaking instruments up on stage, and they were screaming. You know,
right.
You can't even understand what they're saying because
exactly.
They're screaming. They're not really singing a song. They're not trying to, but they're just screaming at the top of their voices, and they put that on TV. And that's all it needs to be done is put on television a couple of times, and it kind of hypnotizes people into considering that, because the people that they put on the television look like them, the people who are watching the program. It's they can identify with the way these people look and slinging the hair around and all of the stuff they do and breaking up instruments and all of that. They can identify with that. Plus, it's entertainment. And it's loud, like you say. It's very loud. And so is other music loud, too. But this is today, it's like that. You know, when we go on to play a concert, me and my brother, we had to, Percy would always go off on the sound engineers because sound engineers were not used to a bass being an accompanying instrument. It had to be so loud until, you know, they would turn it up so loud and he would go off because he would always tell them, all right, now you got it. Don't touch anything. The rest of it, you know, the rest of the sound, let us control if it's loud and if it's soft. We got it. We can control the dynamics. So these guys would be rock-oriented sound engineers. So as soon as we start playing, they turn everything up because they can't hear what we're saying. They don't hear it down at that level. But, you know, a bass is a weird instrument, man. A bass can be in an apartment building 10 floors down or 10 floors up, and you can hear it through the whole building. A bass fiddle, you know, an acoustic bass is a powerful thing. And when you listen to big bands back in the day, like, they didn't have amplifiers, bassy, and those guys. And Duke, you know, but you could hear the bass was always there in the arrangement. You could hear it. And nowadays, everything is pumped up. So it's visual. So that's why rock and roll is so popular. It's very visual. It's all over the place. They don't have jazz concerts in on TV unless you look for a special place to find it. You know, it's not everywhere. You know, but a rock concert, man, is usually loud and it's you can see it. It's always on TV. Like, for instance, I have an endorsement with a drum company called Sonar. And Sonar, after a few years went by, they keep changing these artists and relation people because the job don't pay much, so they quit. So the guys change, and then new young people come in, and they look at the records, and in order for them to keep their jobs, they have to look back at all the clients and see what they're doing, the activity. So my activity is playing in small clubs and some jazz concerts, of course, and a TV show every now and then. I'm on some television show. But so they want to know if, you know, what concerts what group am I playing with? So, I mean, that shows you that it's important to those people to see what you're doing. You have to be active on the television, in the movies and all, and jazz is not usually that music. It's usually rock and roll, and it's very racist, you know, because of the way that the structure of the TV. If you turn on the TV, now the first thing you see is a bunch of people that don't look like you. In all the commercials, every now and then they have one or two people that look like regular people. This whole world is based on who's in control of the media and who controls the record industry and who controls the pop industry and who controls the jazz industry. You know, so those people that control it put themselves or people that look like them in perfect vision so that you can see it and buy the product, whatever it is. If they're selling music, they put on rock and roll music. You know, there's one group that I really like called Fleetwood Mac.
Sure.
I don't know. Now, I like those guys, and I like their music. And then there's another group that I really like, which is not considered pop music, but it was kind of jazzish. It's called Steely Dan. I don't know about now, but years ago, when Victor Feldman was there, the pianist who played with Cannonball for a while, when he was there in the group, it changed the whole complexion of the group. But their music was very interesting, and Steve Gadd as a drummer, I always loved him. And then some of the recordings had Wayne Shorter.
Yeah, you're talking about, it's funny because Lenny White said the same thing about Asia. When he heard Asia, he said, wow, you can.
I love Asia. That's one of my favorite albums, Asia.
No, I named my second daughter Asia, AJA. So,
oh, yeah. That's one of my favorite albums. And those guys, yeah. All of those guys, yeah, you know, the group kind of changed after that that, you know, Victor Feldman died and the group changed. They don't have Steve Gadd anymore, and they don't have a lot of people. So it changed a little bit. And that guy Fagan that sings the lead, I think he's still there, but without the rest of the components, it's not the same. It's like listening to the Ahmad Jamal Trio without Vernell Fournier and Israel Crosby.
I interviewed Ahmad last year, and one of the Vernell. You want to talk about Vernell's rhythm style? Because he was New Orleans drummer.
Sure.
He was an unsung hero.
Yes, he was, and he taught me a lot about tuning the drums and getting a sound. And he got a sound out of the drum kit that was very unusual. And with that trio, for me, Ahmad has not had a trio like that. Nor does he probably want one like that, because that music was so special in those days. And they played in his club for about 5 years before they even recorded, I think. So he had a club in Chicago. I forgot the name of it.
Pershing?
The Persian Room, yeah, well, that's right. Was the Persian Room. They played there for about 5 years until Ahmed didn't, he was not the owner anymore or whatever. They didn't use his name or whatever it was that he was connected with the Persian Room. But that trio with Israel Crosby and Vernell and Ahmad Jamal was the most unique sound I had heard in a long time for a trio. And it was because of those three people together. The chemistry was unbelievable. And now I go see Ahmed. I don't really care for it. Now I don't care for his music. But, I mean, you know, it's like you outgrow certain things. He outgrew trying to play like he was playing with that trio. He went somewhere else as an artist, which is fine. You know, that's, you're supposed to do that. You're not supposed to keep painting the same picture over and over again. That's what Miles Davis said, you know, when he got his group with Tony Williams and all of those wild playing people, Herbie and people like that, and Percy went to see him, and Percy was real upset because it wasn't no more Kenny Clarke, it wasn't no more, you know, Miles Davis wasn't playing like he did. He was more influenced by Don Cherry and Ornette Coleman, which is fine, you know, you're supposed to move on as an artist. So Percy told him, you know, he asked him, how you like the group, you know, and Percy said, man, I'll be back when y'all playing around midnight and all that again. He said, man, we'll never go back to playing that again. I can't. He said he couldn't play that no more. So I understand it. I don't expect Ahmed to play Poinciana and whoever's playing drums to play like Vernell and whoever's playing bass to play like Izzy. I don't expect that, so I don't go see those people. You know, I listen to their recordings that I like. And, you know, with Miles Davis, I understood him changing drummers and changing his music around until he left this planet. But he kept going, and he kind of, at the end of his life, he had went back to John Lee Hooker and all those people, blues people. And he left the Ornette Coleman kind of influence thing. You know, because we all live in this world, and we get influenced by whatever's going on. And here's a guy come along all together that, he says all of the rules suck, and I don't need to be in a certain key, and I don't need to play songs like this or that. I play my own music. And once that happens and you become popular doing that, you start influencing other people to do that. Well, why am I going through all of this, learning all these chords and all of this? You know, I don't need that. I just need to play from my heart. And you have a lot of people who try to imitate. And at one period, I remember Miles got very interested in Don Cherry, because Don Cherry was really quite an improvisational player. But he could also play all of those parts that Ornette had with all those intricate songs. So that group, Higgins, Billy Higgins, Blackwell sometimes, and Charlie Hayden, that was one of the most interesting groups to come along in the 50s in my days.
What? Who?
Go ahead.
I want to make sure. You said Miles went back to start playing with John Lee Hooker at the end?
Yeah, he played with not John Lee Hooker, that other blues player that died recently. He made an album with him.
I'll have to look that up.
I forgot.
This is interesting. So I want to read you, before I let you go, I want to read you this quote, and then I want you to.
And he looked up Prince too. He went and spent a weekend with Prince. And they tell me that they made some music that nobody has been able to find it. It's somewhere in Prince's possessions and some of his stuff. No, they played a little bit together.
It's the I got to look up this blues player. I love Miles' attitude. This is from an interview with Michael Carvin. He said, Joe Chambers said, hey, man, where are you from? I said, Texas. He said, yeah, I'm hip to you. You're playing a jazz top with a rock and roll bottom. I said, don't tell nobody.
Damn.
That's the way I play jazz right now. A jazz top with a rock and roll bottom, because jazz drummers never had a foot. That's what Dizzy dug about me. That's what Freddie Hubbard dug about me. I knew Freddie was going to hire me because he had no choice. Now, this is the part I want you to talk about. Jazz drummers have fantastic hands, but they have a thin sound. They don't have a round sound. How do you create a round sound?
Well, the foot is not used anymore like it used to be. What we say four on the floor means that you play four times with the bass drum. And nowadays, because of Tony Williams and Elvin Jones and those drummers, Roy Haynes, those drummers influenced other drummers to leave the foot out. Max Roach, he left it out too. But Kenny Clarke was one of the original drummers that used to have the foot sound. And Art Blakey had it too. And you could hear the difference. Billy Joe had it as well. You could hear the difference. And then when they played when they played ensemble stuff, the foot would always be gone because the bass player has to have that. He's standing right next to you. So if he can't hear your foot doing four beats to the measure the same as he's doing, then you can't lock in on a rhythm to make a nice cushion for the soloist or the composition or whatever it is you're playing. But you have to have, and the bass players don't want you to play it too loud because it makes the bass sound, the notes sound real short, you know, so you have to be able to feather it, they call it, feather the bass drum. All the old-time drummers used to do it. One person who did it but very loud was Buddy Rich. He was loud, but he would do it through everything.
Right.
And Louis Belson used to do it too. But not as loud as Buddy Rich. Buddy Rich sounded like a truck coming down the street. But his foot was as fast as his hands, and it was as loud as his hands, you know. So he played through the band arrangements. Once he started playing, you boom, 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 boom. You heard that through the whole song. But there are other drummers who did it more eloquently, like Kenny Clarke used to do it. But it was soft and sweet and nice. So when Kenny Clarke was with the MJQ, you could really hear his bass drum technique, as well as when he played with Miles Davis and all those people like that. So there was a technique that you used that these young people don't use anymore. They don't use the foot the same. It's now how much can you do with that now? How many beats can you play with that as opposed to just playing a steady rhythm?
You had your R&B. I think it was fascinating talking to you the first time. You had your R&B upbringing. You played in those kinds of blues settings. You learned how to play the shuffle beat. But, I mean, when I think of Tootie Heath, I mean, you stretch out music and you play a lot of good, great jazz, but you don't have a thin sound. I think a lot of cats think that they have a round sound, but they actually have a pretty thin sound. Well, how did you develop that buoyant sound, that round sound?
Well, my heroes, you know, they all played the foot. Even Max Roach started to become more intellectual with his foot, and he included it in his hand patterns. So he has some very special things that he would do, which were incredible. But he was capable of playing his foot at very fast tempos and incorporating it with the rest of the sound, with the cymbal sound and everything else, is the way Kenny Clarke and those guys did it. And so did Art Blakey do it like that. And so did Philly Joe. All my heroes did it like that. So that's why I try to imitate those guys or get as close to what they were doing as possible.
If you had any recommendation on jazz drummers' feet, you're saying don't keep playing so many notes. Just keep a pulse? I mean, I'm trying to get it at...
Yeah, a pulse, a steady pulse. Like, with both feet should be, you know, the hi-hat is on 2 and 4, and if you're playing in 4-4, the bass drum should be in 4, and the cymbal beat is in between both of those, and then you're improvising with your left hand. So So that's the art of drumming in improvisation, and especially, and there's some guys who are very good at that. Ben Riley was one that I can think of. And Jimmy Cobb, he's one of those traditional guys that play like that. But he's from the old school, you know, so the younger players are not thinking like that. They think of patterns, and like the horns are playing sequences. The young drummers are playing these patterns and multi, what do you call it? Multi.
Paradiddles?
Yeah, rhythmic. Yeah, multi.
Polyrhythms.
Polyrhythmic. Yeah, yeah. Polyrhythmic, which means you're including the foot or both feet in whatever you're doing with your hands. And it's not necessarily keeping a consistent rhythm with your feet. And when you hear a drummer that keeps a consistent beat down there, it's quite different. There's a drummer in New York named Fukushi who plays with Lou Donaldson. He's an expert at that. He can play a drum solo and keep his feet going, both of them. And he'll accompany his hands with his feet. And that's the trick, is to accompany yourself, because you're basically accompanying everybody else, but then when they give you a solo, you're on your own. You know, everybody else lays out, so then you got your feet. You can accompany whatever you're doing with your hands. You can accompany it with your feet. You can keep yourself in line and keep some definition to what you're doing so that people can follow you. If you're skipping around a lot and playing a lot of patterns, I mean, it's like people go, wow, you know, oh, he can do all of that. But it doesn't really capture a feeling like it does when you're keeping the steady rhythm with your feet.
Yeah, I mean, you wind up staring, honestly, as an observer or as a listener, you wind up staring at the wall.
Oh, you smoke a joint and come and listen.
I mean, yeah, you take a break, smoke a joint. But the thing is,
yeah,
go smoke.
Or you get drunk and listen.
Can you just give the audience worldwide an update on my main man M2M? And because I was shocked to hear about him. He got knocked down pretty good. He was in the hospital, and now
I just talked to his wife just a minute ago, right before you, and she said he's coming home. And I talked to him yesterday. He said he was hoping to come home one day this week, but she said he's being released tomorrow, so he'll come home from the rehab. And she sent me a picture of him walking. He had really been paralyzed because of a nerve in his neck that went to his spine. He was actually paralyzed. He couldn't walk. And then through about 2 weeks of therapy, he's coming home and he's walking and going upstairs and doing all that. And she sent me a picture of him walking with nothing, just walking. He was leaning against the wall. Then he had the first day I watched him walk, he had one of those walkers. Then now, next time I looked, he was leaning against the wall and taking small steps. Now he's walking again with nothing. So he's 100% better.
You tell him I'm praying for him, and I also want to let you know, Tootie, I would love to come to Santa Fe to hang with you sometime, man. It would be I'm also in Mesa, Arizona, in July. I'm hosting a roundtable discussion with Dom Fumalaro, Billy Cobham, Dean Brown on we're talking rhythm. It's going to be a live streamed conversation, and part of me wants to invite you down here to come to that if you're around.
I would love it. But anyhow, are you in New York next week?
I'm in Tucson, baking out here, man.
You're in Tucson.
Yeah, I mean,
is that where you live, in Arizona?
Yeah, I'm a Long Island cat. I grew up in Long Island, but I live here. Yeah, I live right next door.
Okay.
I live next door to you in, you know, Santa Fe.
Yeah, right. Arizona's right next door.
That's right.
Well, you know, I'm playing at Mesro Friday and Saturday in New York City, so I was going to invite you to come by. I'm with Ethan and David Williams.
I interviewed David about 5 years ago. I've done 1,000 interviews, Tootie. I mean, it's just been so intoxicating, and much love to you, man, and keep swinging, and we'll be in touch. I'd love to get you down to Mesa for this drum talk. It'll be a blast.
Well, one of these times you will, so I'm going to look forward to it.
All right, brother. Have a great day, man.
All right, you too. Bye-bye.
Bye-bye. Just heard from a master drummer, Albert Tootie Heath. That was the second installment of our interview, and we have more work to do. In the meantime, we're going to rejoin the Jim Parisi Show.